Good morning. I'm Alan, and I'm glad that you're here for our online Sunday Bible study. I hope you have your Bible with you or an app to read on your phone or tablet or Kindle and follow along with us. Today we are looking at God Loves a Cheerful Giver. If you've been following along in this study, I've said that several times. Well, this is the verse where the Apostle Paul highlights that thought that God loves a cheerful giver. And it's in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 15. And we will finish out chapter 9 in today's reading. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the facts, the information, and most of all, the guidance on how to live the best life, honoring and glorifying you that we find in it. We ask you to bless this reading and bless us as we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Again, I'm glad that you're here. And beginning in verse 6, it says this: Remember this, a farmer who plants only a few seeds will get a small crop, but the one who plants generously will get a generous crop. And what Paul says, giving to offerings or giving in response to a need or someone asking, Paul says giving is like sowing seeds that you reap in proportion to what you sow. So the more seeds that you put down or plant into the ground, the more whatever you're going to get, whether it's pumpkins, cucumbers, flowers, tomatoes, whatever it is, the more seeds you plant, the more you will get back in return. And so Paul is saying, the more money that you give, the more generosity, the more that you will get in response to your giving. And so Paul is saying very plainly here that giving is to be methodical. In other words, you're to have a plan for giving, but it's also supposed to be cheerful. And if you give in this way, God will make sure that you have enough for your own needs and enough to give away. Verse 7, you must each decide in your hearts how much to give. And don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure, for God loves a person who gives cheerfully. So when we are asked to give, we need to determine in our heart what we want to give. And we can and should consider what's necessary for ourselves. In other words, we don't want to give away the rent money, the utility money. We always have a little bit that we can give, but we need to make sure that we have enough for our necessities, and we have the promise that God will bless us in our giving and make sure that we have enough for ourselves and also to give. All of us have expenses we have during normal life, but at the same time, we need to think of fellow Christians, fellow believers who are going through a tough time, who may not have what they need. And so we should be willing to give in response to that. We should be given because we have been blessed and our giving will in turn bless others. And so taking all of those things together, we should not give reluctantly. It's possible for us to give and not be happy about it. It's also possible to give under the pressure of emotional appeal. Some of these ads that we see on TV, or that I've seen on TV and you may have seen on TV, they use a very emotional appeal. Or some people will use public embarrassment to get people to give. And Paul's saying that is not how it should be. We should give willingly. We should be cheerful about giving. See, that's what God wants from us. He wants us to be cheerful givers, and we need to give in response to what's prompted in our hearts. And above all else, God loves a cheerful giver. We have a word in the English language, hilarious, which is joyful, laughing, full of lots of joy. Well, the word cheerful is translated from the Greek hilarion, which is where we get our Greek, our English word hilarious. So that's the type of giving, that's the type of feeling that we should have when we give. Now, here's the thing. Does God really need our money? No, he does not. He owns the cattle on the thousand hills, or thousand cattle on the hill. What Paul is pointing out here, what he's telling us, is God looks at the heart attitude. And that's what it's important to God. It's not the fact that we gave $1,000 or $1,000,000 or $1. It's the attitude of our heart when we give the money. He loves to see a Christian so filled with joy that he wants to share what he has with others. Verse 8, and God will generously provide all you need. Then you will always have everything you need and plenty left over to share with others. Now here we have a promise that if a person really wants to be generous, God will see that we are given the opportunity. God can supply us with the resources. God can supply us with the things that we need so that we will be able to share what we have with others. And so we'll have an abundance. We'll have the resources to share for every good work. Verse 9, as the scriptures say, they share freely and give generously to the poor. Their good deeds will be remembered forever. Here in verse 9, Paul is quoting from Psalm 112, verse 9. And the specific kindness talked about here is given to the poor. Are we losers by doing this? Absolutely not. Because as the psalmist says, the righteousness of our giving lasts forever. And so that means if we give in kindness, same as the farmer sows his seed, we will be laying up for ourselves treasures in heaven. And what this means is our kindness will last forever. Verse 10. For God is the one who provides seed for the farmer and then bread to eat. In the same way, he will provide and increase your resources and then produce a great harvest of generosity in you. Paul is continuing the illustration of the farmer planting seeds here. He says, the same God who provides the seed to the farmer and bread for food is very careful to make sure that those who sow kindness, who show kindness to others, they will reap or receive certain rewards. And that's good news. Some of those rewards are listed here. First, God is going to multiply the seed that we have planted. That is, God will give us greater opportunities and more abundant results by showing kindness to his people. And furthermore, he will increase our resources, and in turn, we will be able to increase our generosity. And so as God increased the Corinthians' ability to give, they in turn increased their generosity, their giving, so that the rewards they would receive would increase accordingly. Verse 11. Yes, you will be enriched in every way so that you can always be generous. And when we take your gifts to those who need them, they will thank God. Well, it's certainly clear from this section that a person never makes himself poor by giving to the Lord. Rather, every act of kindness that we do has a reflex action. And the reward is out of proportion to the gift given. In other words, we always receive back more than we've given. And so Paul says here that Christians, the Corinthians, by their giving, would be enriched in everything so that they could do further displays of kindness and giving. And as the apostles, as the disciples, as the believers looked on and saw the Corinthians growing in the grace of giving, all the people who saw this would give great thanks to God. Verse 12. So two good things will result from the ministry of giving. The needs of the believers in Jerusalem will be met, and they will joyfully express their thanks to God. When the gift from the Corinthians, the offering, the money, the love offering, was put to work in Jerusalem, it would not only supply the needs of the saints, but it would also result in many people giving thanks to God. Anything that results in the Lord being thanked is of great importance in Paul's eyes. Verse 13, as a result of your ministry, the Corinthians giving of the offering and sending it to Jerusalem, as the result of your ministry, they will give glory to God. For your generosity to them and to all believers will prove that you are obedient to the good news of Christ. And so Paul mentions some other benefits that will result from the Corinthians' gift. It would be definite proof to the Judean Christians that there really had been a work of Christ in the lives of these Gentile converts. In other words, Jesus had changed their lives and changed their hearts. And so this kindness that they were giving of the offering would be to the Jerusalem believers great proof of the reality of the faith of the Corinthians, the ones who gave the gift to help the Jerusalem believers. And they would glorify God for what the gospel of Jesus had done in Achaia, as well as for the great contribution which had been given to them. Verse 14, and they will pray for you with deep affection because of the overflowing grace God has given you. And Paul continues, that's not all. Two more benefits follow. Because of this gift from the Corinthian church to Jerusalem, the Jewish Christians would be careful to pray for the saints in Corinth, and they would have this tie, this bond of affection, because of what the Corinthians had done for the Jerusalem believers. Verse 15. And so at this point, Paul just breaks out into great praise. He's happy, he's joyful, he's glad what he's seeing, and he has this praise. And then he's thinking of the greatest giver of all, God himself. And also, he's thinking of the greatest gift that God has given, the Lord Jesus Christ, who provides us salvation, forgiveness of sins, and an eternal home in heaven if we believe and follow him and become disciples. So that should be our goal, being cheerful givers and being cheerful followers, disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm glad that you joined us here this morning. Don't forget, we are continuing in the book of Revelation. You can join us here in Paris for that message series. And if you can't make it to Paris, watch us online, Facebook or YouTube. It's a great message. I think we're learning lots of great things, and we're seeing glimpses of what God has in the future for believers and non-believers. So I hope that you'll join us or watch us, and have a great Sunday.